Five, four, three, two, one. The Sofa Club is live.
Hi, welcome back to Peccadillo Sofa Club with the Q&A, which is live. We are here tonight from Belgium and the UK. And here is Laurent Micheli, who's the writer and director of Lola and the Sea. And Mia Boles, who is the star of the film. And we have Juliette Dante, who's going to do translations for us. So we're very multilingual tonight. And obviously, we're being supported in the background by technical people, which I'll thank later. So welcome, everybody, to the screening. Those who have seen the film before, I know it was screened in the UK at Fringe Film Festival as well as tonight. Don't forget, it's also out in cinemas on Friday and on Peccadillo Pod. So starting with my first question, Laurent. I just think this film is incredible in the way that you've managed to depict the nuances of trans life in a way, but also I know the main protagonist is trans, but it's a film about grief and loss and teenagehood, really. So how did you come about choosing these themes for this film? Because you're neither, I don't know your experience of grieving, so maybe there's something to do with that, but you're not trans and you're not a girl. So what's all this about, Laurent?
Well, I don't know exactly about grief, but it seems like I'm quite used to write death as the beginning of a story. I don't know why, but something in my brain does that. Well, you know, I think being a filmmaker is kind of a privilege. So because you have the opportunity to bring stories to people, and I want to use that privilege to make people think about maybe stories, characters they don't really know about. So this is why at some point I wanted to write a story about a trans character, a trans girl. It seems for me that since then, a lot of films try to talk about that, but in some way that was kind of okay, but not my way of telling that kind of story. I really wanted to stop telling that trans people are born in the wrong body, for example, but more in the wrong society, and to make people think that they have the opportunity to make other people, and in that situation trans people, feel good about themselves. Because, you know, it's not only about, okay, I'm trans, I have a dysphoria and I feel bad about myself. No, I don't think it's about that. I think it's more about how people look at you, treat you. And maybe if we all have if we all realize that we have the power to make other people feel good or bad, maybe it would help. So that was some kind of the political statement. And of course, there is another thing which is more intimate. Can we say that?
Yeah.
I really wanted to go back into my own teenagehood, which is a moment of life where you have to define yourself in front of the society, of other people, of your parents, your family. I experienced that, not as a trans person, but as a gay man, for example, and as a human being. So I felt a lot of anger in that time of my life, and I really wanted to take that and to bring it into a character. This is where Lola, the character of Lola, is really close to me.
Yeah, and you know, I felt the same way. It was very much around that teenage time when you're trying to, you need your parents, but you want to kick back at them at the same time, and you're very angry. And I think there's a layer of anger that LGBTQ kids have that we don't really see a lot in the cinema. So this film is really important and powerful in that way. I just want to ask one more question before I turn to Mia. I read in an interview, excuse me, that you said you very much wanted to cast the trans actress, but you couldn't find one in the kind of the realm of political professional actresses. Yeah. And because so you world, had to go out.
Yeah, because the world is like that at the moment. You know, it's a problem of visibility, and so that's why it was really important for me to give that part, that character, to a trans person, because again, it's a political statement. We need visibility as minorities. And of course, it seems like it's difficult to find a trans actress which is supposed to be 18 years old and trained as an actress in Belgium and in France and in Switzerland. And it doesn't exist. So what should we do? Should we turn into giving that part to a cis person? I don't think so. I think we have to push walls, you know, and doors, and we need to make a reality what we think it's good and important. So this is why we did that casting, and we tried to go into, to get into trans person, and yeah, you know, let's see what's going to happen. We don't know, but this is why we began the casting a lot before the shooting, like a year and a half before the shooting, because we didn't know if it was going to be easy or not. But for me, it was so important to find a trans person for that part that we started really early, and at the end we found Mia.
And you know, it's a lot to do that, I understand, you know, as a filmmaker, and you probably have the funders on your back as well about casting, because as we all know, casting is important for marketing and publicity, and it's often used like that. So Mia was and is a newcomer, but really incredibly won the Best Newcomer Award, the Magritte Award in Belgium. So congratulations, Mia, for that. I think it's well deserved. Your performance was super. So I'm going to ask you the question in what made you want to be in this film? Because you hadn't acted before, but you're coming to this film. Like, what like attracted you to do this film and to do it, to be involved?
Qu'est-ce qui t'a poussé? Qu'est-ce qui t'a attiré dans le projet, puisque tu n'avais jamais joué avant?
En fait, j'ai trouvé l'annonce sur les réseaux sociaux et c'était pas pour moi une envie d'être actrice ou de travailler dans le milieu artistique en général. C'est juste vraiment que j'avais rien à faire ce jour-là et j'ai répondu à l'annonce comme ça. Et puis la directrice de casting a très vite répondu. Et puis de fil en aiguille, au bout du compte, j'ai passé un casting à Bruxelles. Et puis après, il y a eu différentes étapes. Mais à la toute base, c'était pas...
cette partie-là, ça va, je suis ravie, ça.
Je dis juste que c'était simplement en fait une envie d'expérience, mais pas forcément... d'acting en tout cas.
So actually, I saw the ad in social media and it didn't come from a real desire to be part of a film. It was really on a Sunday and I was kind of bored and it was curiosity made me respond and the casting director reacted and I had a casting session initially with her and then with them and then went to Paris for a second casting session. But really, initially, it just was fluke in a way.
So you were bored, Mia. And so how did you find it then, you know, being on a film shoot? Because it is quite grueling. How did you find it?
Et donc, comment as-tu trouvé l'expérience? Parce que tu t'ennuyais, mais après, de se retrouver comme ça sur un tournage, c'est épuisant, c'est du travail.
Beaucoup de travail.
C'est un travail qui... Le tournage a duré à peu près 2 mois, mais il y a quand même eu près d'un an et demi de travail avant avec des coachs de jeu, dont une qui m'a également suivie sur le tournage. Donc, très fatigant et un investissement personnel assez intense. Mais, ouais. Mais positif, forcément, positif et bon pour soi, sa confiance, son image, et toutes ces choses.
Well, it was obviously 2 months of shoot, but before that, a year and a half of preparation with an acting coach who was then following me and being there supporting on set. So it was exhausting, but also good for me and positive, very positive in myself as well.
Merci, Mia. I have some other questions, but I'm going to go to Laurent now. Laurent, look, I wanted to ask you one technical question, right? Because the film is in this format, which looks like if it was made for Instagram in a way. I want to ask you, like, why did you shoot it in that aspect ratio and not like, you know, everything's all like wide, super wide. And yeah. Here we have something looking old school and Instagram-y like.
Yeah, it was definitely not for Instagram. That was not the point. but it was for a few reasons. One of them was, you know, when you are making a road movie, you usually are going to think like something really wide because you have a lot of landscapes and things like that. But I really wanted to do the opposite. Why? Because I wanted that the frame could talk about the relationships of the father and the daughter. They are always in the same place, in the same rooms, but they are not really together in a way, you know? So it was really important for me to spread them. Can we say that? Yeah. So, it was like basically they are together, but they are not really together. They can't understand each other. So I want to spread them, separate them. Another point was kind of political again. It was like, okay, for me, it's really important to portray that girl and to make the audience watch her face, which is, she's a trans person, she's a trans character, okay? So you are not used to see a trans person as a leading part in the film. So I want you to sit and look at her. So everything that is going to be around her, I want to make it disappear. So your eyes are going to focus on her face, on her emotions. That was the other thing. And maybe the last reason was because, you know, this is a road movie, and of course this is a physical journey from a point to another, but also it's about memory in family stories. Sometimes you are like talking about your past, your memories, and you can feel that you didn't really, how to say that, live the same stories. It's the same memory, but you have different point of view. So yeah, it was something really going into the past for that daughter and her father. So because how do you say that in English? 4-3 frame?
4-3 ratio.
Yeah, 4-3. Yeah, 4-3 ratio.
It's an old ratio, so it was also about that, you know, going in the past.
Ah, okay. Like the memory yeah, of both of them, of the mother and of the mm-hmm. time, because they both had different interpretations, and you found that when they went to the sea, yeah?
Yeah.
I thought the character of the father, played by Benoît Magimel. By the way, people in the audience, please send your questions in, because we're going to be wanting your questions to Laurent and Mia. So please send as many questions in as possible, and I will direct them to both of our guests. So thank you. I found the character of Benoît very interesting in that he was, for the first time in a film, the cishet white man was the outsider. So, yeah, you know, when the women were together, he interrupted everything. Like every yeah, time he came, he was interrupting something. He was interrupting the space in the shelter, which had people of color, queer people, outsiders, when they went to the sex club. The sex workers were together, and then when he came into the room, it was all uncomfortable. So it was really interesting, the kind of cishet white guy being not the one, in a way, not the center. Can you say a little bit more about that? Because that is quite unusual.
I think in a way it's kind of natural for me to do that. but
go on.
But you know, also it was really important to me that, okay, I'm not going to forgive that man as a writer and a director. I don't want to say this is all good to act and think like that, but I'm more as a person, I want to work on inclusivity, inclusions, and to like I want us to work and live together. So in a way it was kind of important that this character was not only the bad guy, you know. He has to have feelings. He's trying, but he's trying bad. He loves his daughter, but and not in a good way. So I wanted to show his struggle. But I never wanted to apologize his behavior. So yeah, and it was kind of difficult for me to write that character, actually, because I'm more close to the character of Lola. Yeah. And I'm not a father. I'm cis, okay, but I'm not straight, and I don't think like him at all. So this character was the most difficult one to write. But again, it was important that for that film, it was important that the audience could have two doors to get into the story. Of course, you have the character of Lola and people that are living the same kind of life. They were going to be on her side, but also I wanted to touch another kind of audience, because you have a lot of people that need to learn. And so this character, Philippe, the father, was made and right for that purpose. Yeah. Because at the end, what we want is people to understand each other, right? It's not only about saying we live like that. We think you should change your state of mind, of course. But how can we do that? How can we help people to change?
Absolutely, and I felt what you said about his character. You could see his vulnerability and his pain. And when he spoke about his father, you could tell there were some intergenerational aspects of that. You know, he himself wasn't parented very lovingly, you know, as a boy. So it's very complex. So thank you for that complex character too. Mia, you know, thinking about the role, and I know there was a lot of improv in the film. What did you bring with any research that you'd done? Because, you know, Lola is not you. So how did you research your role, you know, the role you played?
Ça va? Comment as-tu fait tes recherches pour le personnage, le rôle de Lola, qui bien évidemment n'est pas toi? Et il croit comprendre qu'il y a aussi eu de l'improvisation, mais personnellement, en tant que recherche pour le personnage, comment as-tu procédé?
Il n'y a pas eu d'improvisation en tant que telle. Non, il n'y a pas eu d'improvisation tout court, Laurent, je pense.
Très peu, ouais.
Ouais, très peu. Donc, en fait, pour Lola, j'ai aussi travaillé avec Laurent en amont du tournage, et je me souviens qu'on cherchait, par exemple, la façon que Lola pouvait marcher dans la rue, la façon dont elle pouvait rouler des cigarettes, enfin, tout ce genre de choses. Donc, c'est des petits détails, en fait, mais qui ont servi à enrichir et puis épaissir la personnalité du personnage afin de la trouver. Donc voilà.
Voilà.
Ahead of the show, I also worked with Laurent, and it was really more working on a physicality, sort of ways of walking, ways of possibly rolling your cigarette, how Lola would walk, how she would do certain details, and all these details helped flesh her out.
You know, it was really important for me that Mia, of course, that was her first experience, and I wanted us to make something that can protect us, her, sorry, because of course you are going to play with your emotions, your own emotions. This is going to be true, but the character is not you, so we have to find and to make up a character. And this is really important, because at some point when a scene is done, you have to step out of the character to protect yourself. You know, this notion is really important. And when you begin acting, it's not always easy to find that. So of course we search for what is the body of Lola? What is her way to, of course, to move, to walk, to to drink, to smoke a cigarette.
And to smoke a cigarette, yeah, loads of
because he smokes a lot, actually. No, but you know, it's interesting to focus on that really tiny details, because it helps you to say, oh, okay, I would roll a cigarette like this, but maybe the character is going to do it in another way. So that helps you to realize that this is not you. And another thing is that the character is skateboarding, and Mia wasn't skateboarding at all. And she had a lot of lessons, and I went to the lesson with her a lot, because it's a strange world, the skateboarding world, and it's really a lot of masculinity. So, but for us, I think it was for us, it was important to say, okay, that girl before transitioning, she was doing skateboarding, she's going to do it still after it, because that's something she likes. So how can we define that character in that kind of world? So I was telling to Mia when we were in that the skateboarding courses, let's look at all those guys and girls. How are they acting, reacting? What kind of clothes do they wear? Things like that, and it helps to go into a character.
Yes, and you know, that's why I asked the question, because it's often, I think people, when they think, oh, a trans actress playing a trans role, they're not really acting, and you're just like, well, they're not playing themselves. And even if you play yourself, you're still acting.
Yeah.
So it's a really important point, and we need to drive that home. And I loved the skateboarding aspects of Lola. I thought they were super. But you
are
skateboard now.
I don't think she agreed, but
I know.
Ask her.
Je n'ai pas trop d'accord apparemment avec les tout ce qui était skate, parce que Campbell dit qu'il a adoré tout cet aspect-là et ce que tu fais dans le film.
Ça rend bien, mais c'était pas facile à vivre.
Non, c'est pas facile.
It wasn't easy even to live through.
Yeah, it is quite challenging. There's some questions that are coming through. So keep them coming, Amelia. I'm seeing them. So I'm not actually doing social media on my phone. I'm looking at questions. So there's a question to Mia. Did you get emotionally attached to the film or to the film from Kaz?
Est-ce que
Hi,
tu
Kaz.
Senti donc une question de Kaz qui demande si tu t'es senti attaché de manière émotionnelle au film ou à certaines parties du film?
Oui, forcément, il y a des parties du film qui ont été plus fortes pour moi à jouer que d'autres, parce qu'elles avaient peut-être une similitude, non pas dans le moment, mais une similitude en tout cas émotionnelle qui pouvait me rappeler certaines émotions, certains passages vécus, ressentis, quoi. Donc voilà.
Yes, of course. I mean, some parts were potentially stronger or harder to do, or stronger from an emotional point of view, not necessarily in the actual action of the film, but because possible similar emotions I have experienced in the past myself came back in that context.
Thanks. And I think that's for most of us trans people, Mia, we had the same reactions. I felt when the dad was kept misgendering Lola, I was like, shut up, just shut up. So if you can pass that to Mia as well for me, Juliette.
Yes, donc, je ne sais pas si tu as suivi ce que Campbell a dit, mais c'est pour lui aussi l'expérience en tant que personne trans. Quand le père insiste d'utiliser le mauvais pronom continuellement. Il avait vraiment, lui, en regardant en tant que spectateur, était là, mais tais-toi, arrête. Donc, cette expérience très forte auquel on peut s'identifier.
Oui, c'est vrai. Moi, ce n'est pas quelque chose que j'ai forcément vécu dans mon entourage. Enfin, une partie, mais pas autant. J'ai pas eu de réticence tant que celle du père de Lola. Mais c'est vrai que même moi, en tant qu'actrice, des fois, j'en avais marre qu'il appelle Lola parce que je me disais, mais putain, Lola, c'est bon, quoi, tu vois. Dans l'idée de... C'est plus en voyant le film que j'ai eu ça qu'en le jouant, parce qu'en voyant le film, vraiment, je me disais, mais enfin, on fait un effort. Mais on oublie que ce film se passe sur 3 jours de temps. Et une réconciliation complète et absolue ne serait pas possible en 3 jours. Et donc, le chemin qui est déjà fait vers la mer est absolument déjà énorme, en fait. Et donc, je peux comprendre qu'on ait envie de dire à ce père, mais enfin, ressaisis-toi, mais en même temps, ce père est très humain et il est, en mon sens, très réel et représentatif de beaucoup de parents dans le monde, en fait.
Oui.
So, personally, I didn't experience that much reticence directly from most of the family or friends around me. But as an actress, it was often on set, I was annoyed with the father character forever misgendering me. But also, it was more afterwards watching it I felt that. Having said that, he is really very representative, the father, of and real human as a father. And if you think that the journey is a 3-day journey, it's impossible to get a full reconciliation in that time. So it's quite amazing what is already happening. So it's quite a good journey to get that in 3 days.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you, Mia. And by the way, that was Kaz from Trans Pride Southwest Bristol. Shout out to you, Kaz. And there's another question from Deborah Shaw. Deborah loved the film and Lola. She reminded me a bit physically of Nomi in Sense8. And I noted the use of Four Non Blondes song. Was that a deliberate reference to Sense8?
Absolutely. So,
oh, look at that. Yes, Deborah, you heard it.
And yeah, you know, you were...
Talk about the music, because I thought it was amazing.
You were talking earlier about the father and how he always interrupts situations. For me, it was like kind of important to tell that we have kind of sorority and that we are, as minorities, a team. I don't know if that makes sense in English, but it makes in French.
Yes,
and for sense. Me, it was important to tell that we are strong together and that we are a community. I'm not afraid of that word. I think we need it. I think it's not all that we need, but I think it's kind of really, really important to be equalized in our lives. So, of course, I wanted to make a clin d'œil. I don't know what's the word in English. Something like a reference.
Like a nod.
Yes, yeah. A note. Yes, homage.
To Sense8, because that show was really important, I think. And I loved it. And of course, before that show, that song was kind of important to me. I like it. And at the end, you know, it's funny because all the singers, the musicians that we use in the film are queer people. It was not really. It was not a total choice at the beginning, but at the end, it was, okay, we have Four Non Blondes, we have Anoni, yeah. And we have Boy George, and This is really good.
And you have Maria Callas as well,
America,
who is a queer icon. So I loved the music, by the way. There's a question from Finn to Mia. There's a question to Mia and there's a question to Laurent. Mia, did you have a trans worker to support you in the experience, like an assistant who was trans on the film?
Donc la question est si tu as eu quelqu'un qui te soutenait en tant que trans, en tant que personne trans, une personne trans qui était là sur le tournage.
Non, mais Laurent a fait un travail absolument magnifique. Il s'est entouré d'une personne bienveillante, safe, toujours dans l'empathie et dans l'entraide. Et ça, c'est quelque chose qui m'a beaucoup aidée sur le tournage. J'avais pas de personnes trans avec moi, mais j'avais énormément de personnes qu'on m'appelle queer. Donc ça, c'était vraiment bien. Et à côté de ça, j'avais dans mon entourage ma bande de copines qui m'ont suivie un peu durant du casting jusqu'au tournage et puis jusqu'à la vision du film. J'ai été entourée de personnes qui étaient concernées par ça.
So no, I didn't have technically a coordinator or trans support worker on set, but Laurent did an amazing, wonderful job working in terms of research and the work he did to prepare, working with empathy and helping each other out. And I was also on set surrounded by many queer people on the set itself. So I felt supported, including my girlfriends who have been there from the beginning, that followed me and supported me from casting straight through to and through the shoot and straight through to the screenings and the release of the film.
So you had a posse with you, Mia. You had an entourage.
J'avais un entourage qui te soutenait.
Il faut toujours avoir un entourage autour de soi.
You always need one around you.
You're so right. Tu as raison. And the same Finn is asking you the question, were other trans people on the crew or, you know, in the cast? And I know you spoke about working, part of your process was working with the trans community. So maybe say a little bit about that.
As far as I know, I don't think there were other trans people on the set, but I don't know everything.
Sure,
but
yeah.
As Mia said, it was really, really, really important to me that the cast, the team was going to be really safe and open-minded. So when we were in preparation of the film, I took every chief of chef de poste, I don't know the word in English, but
head of department.
Yeah, exactly. And I said, okay, we are going to work on that story, and we are going to have a main trans actress. Of course, you can have questions. Phone and emails are always open to ask questions, but as soon as someone will have some transphobic behavior, for me it's going to be the door, you know, you are going to be kicked out because this is not allowed on my set. So I think head chief of departments choose their own team really precisely about the project. That's something. And another thing is, okay, it was really important to me that as a cis person, writing a story about a trans person, I didn't want to tell bad things or mistakes. So I've been surrounded by trans people during all the making process of the film, the writing process, the shooting, and after that the editing. I invite people, trans people, to see what I was working on, and that leads to some questions, discussions, and that was really fun. That's what I wanted. But I don't know, for example, I'm working on a new film right now. I'm writing a new film, and I'm already meeting new technical person, and I really want to bring on my set more and more queer and trans people as far as it's possible, you know, because it's like the actress acting questions. You don't have a lot of in Belgium trans people working in the cinema industry, but it's coming now, and I want to work with them, of course.
Yes, thank you. I mean, that's very inspiring, Laurent, and thanks for sharing your process with us, because it's not just the end product as well, which was superb, but it's also how you got to that.
You cannot tell a story that is far from the way you are making that story. It's not possible. That's not okay for me. You have to make a balance, you know. You have to make the world you are telling people, you know what I mean?
Yes, to have a relationship to the world that you're telling the story of.
Yeah,
and it's, as you know, Laura, I mean, we have to say this because it's not often done, you know. No. And it's sad that that's something that has to be obviously said, because mostly people just parachute in, do the story, and then it's like they have no relationship to it at all, you know, and it's usually for nefarious reasons. But anyway, thanks for sharing that. And there's a question from Simon for Mia. Are you wanting to do more acting? Possibly not skateboarding, maybe. And is it important for trans folk to see acting as a viable type of work?
Donc, as-tu envie de continuer dans une carrière en tant qu'actrice? Est-ce que c'est important pour les personnes trans de voir que c'est viable, qu'il y a une carrière pour eux dans ce domaine de travail?
Je pense que c'est viable pour certaines personnes en fonction des choix de carrière, en fonction des choix de films qu'on fait. Ça l'est pas forcément pour tout le monde. Moi, honnêtement, j'ai un regard assez pessimiste sur la question du cinéma en tant que personne trans en France. Et un regard aussi assez réducteur, où c'est souvent le même type de rôle et les mauvais mêmes types de rôles, donc même pas des rôles intéressants et réellement construits. Donc voilà, après la question, c'est que j'ai déjà fait d'autres petits tournages. Je ne pense pas continuer en tant qu'actrice, j'en ai pas forcément. C'est pas un manque d'envie, mais c'est un manque de pérennité. C'est quelque chose d'assez fatigant, de prenant, de passer des castings, et il n'y a pas forcément de retour derrière. Et donc voilà. Et de ce principe, et j'ai quand même l'impression que le cinéma français, les réalisateurs français, ne sont pas forcément chauds de prendre une personne trans pour jouer une personne cis. Et donc, moi, personnellement, en tant que Mia Bollars, je ne crois pas avoir une carrière dans le cinéma. Mais je pense que la porte est carrément ouverte et qu'il y a plein d'autres personnes trans qui auront des carrières absolument exceptionnelles. Et c'est déjà le cas, je connais des acteurs et des actrices trans qui ont des carrières en France. Donc voilà.
Well, it's can be viable in terms of some trans people, depending on the choices you make. I personally have a rather pessimistic view of the film industry in France, regarding France, because the types of roles you are often offered seem to be the same, not very good ones, and certainly not interesting ones, especially in terms of depiction as a trans person. I've done some more shoots, but I don't think that I will continue fully with it as a career. It's really from a point of view also that it's tiring, and it's in terms of emotionally, and you don't really get a feedback. So there's such a lack of feedback in the industry, and the cinema industry in France is really not yet there, not very warm towards the idea of a trans woman playing, or a trans character, a trans person playing a cis person. And that's still something that's there. So as far as I'm concerned, I don't think I will, but it doesn't mean that it's not open to others. And I do know that it's already the case for some trans actors who are having a career in cinema in France.
Thank you. We would cast you in the UK in loads of roles.
So, Royaume-Uni, on te donnerait tellement de rôles.
Je ne parle pas assez bien anglais, malheureusement.
Nah, we do in French.
I'll help, je t'aiderai.
Yeah. Ralph's got a question for you, Mia, and it's one every actor might feel. It's when you first saw yourself on the big screen, how did you feel?
C'est une question que chaque acteur ressent ou a ressenti quelque chose. La première fois que tu t'es vu à l'écran, qu'est-ce que ça t'a fait?
C'est pas que... Laurent a eu la bonne idée de ne pas me montrer de vidéos de moi, enfin de plans de moi, de séquences de moi pendant le tournage. Donc j'ai eu la joie de me découvrir en post-synchro. La première fois que j'ai vu le film en entier, je me suis sentie émue, j'ai trouvé ça très bien, mais c'était surtout parce que ça me rappelait toutes les émotions du film, tout l'investissement émotionnel que ça avait été. Sinon, c'est pas un plaisir de me voir jouer. Je remarque tous les défauts sur mon corps, j'ai envie de refaire tout mon visage. C'est assez dysphorique en fait pour moi de me voir jouer. Mais de l'autre côté, c'est plutôt positif parce qu'en même temps, ça m'amène un regard dans le sens où j'ai quand même réussi à faire ça dans ma vie alors que je ne m'y destinais pas du tout, et ça c'est cool. Mais donc, je dirais un truc assez mitigé. J'aime pas forcément me voir jouer. Donc voilà.
So, Laurent had the right idea not to show me any rushes throughout the shoot, and I discovered myself when we were doing the post-sync work afterwards. And yeah, when I first saw the film, of course, it brought back emotions and I was moved because of the moments, because of the context of the scenes. But it wasn't a pleasure to look at myself. And there was something very dysphoric about it because I noticed every fault and I wanted to change every bit of my body, of my face. It was just not a pleasant experience. But in the positive of it, it did make me realize that I was there on screen and I did succeed in doing that.
Yes, thank you. And you did win an award.
Je dirais aussi que c'est dur parce que je vois mes cheveux dans quel état ils étaient et ça me fait du mal.
That I see the state my hair was in and that's really painful.
It suited the role. I just want to, we're going to have to wrap up. It's such an amazing conversation. I could go on and on. But one of the things I wanted to ask you, Laurent, Something that I noted was your film was very ethnically diverse, which I thought, Belgium, amazing to see that. And you said that you'd started an organization or a group that was to increase diversity in cinema.
I've been joining as an administrator the French-speaking directors of Belgium. So since it's been a year and a half now, and I opened the question of diversity there. So there is a lot of work. And this is something really important to me, again, because I think we have the privilege of sharing stories and sharing some or the way that we see the world. And sometimes you have to force again things to bring diversity. And you know, in Lola, of course, you had the character of Lola, which is a trans character, but also, for example, you had the character of Samir, which is the Lola's best friend. It was written as an Arabic boy. It's okay to say that in English?
Yeah, Arabic, yeah.
Arabic boy. But for example, the not the director, but the guy working in the
shelter.
There was no ethnicity written in the script for that part. And with my casting director, we have a lot of conversation about that, saying, okay, I don't say it's a black or a white person or whatever, but you please make me meet every actor as possible, because and for that character specifically, we cast a lot of different actors, and it, yeah, the best one was a black actor, so that was for him, you know. And it's, everything is important. It's important to write specific characters that are part of a community or minority, but it's also really important not to define what is that character or that other character, because that is part of our work, to bring diversity in the screen.
Yes, thanks. And it showed, and also having the older woman who was a sex worker. I mean, there's so many beautiful layers in your film, Laurent, in terms of that, but not in a forced way, which I thought was really good.
Don't thank me, because it's just the way I see people and the world, that's all.
Yeah. I love the way you see the world, and I'm looking forward to your next film. Yes. I'm looking forward to whatever you do next, Mia. Have you got any things in the pipeline that you want to secretly tell us?
As-tu peut-être des projets que tu aimerais bien partager avec nous secrètement?
Si un éditeur cherche à traduire et à éditer un magnifique roman que j'ai écrit, je suis preneuse. Non, j'ai écrit un roman, donc je cherche un éditeur actuellement, plus sérieusement. Sinon, j'ai pas de projet dans le cinéma actuellement.
So, well, if an editor is interested in taking on my novel and having it translated, it'd be great. I have actually seriously written a novel, and I'm hoping that will take off, but I don't have any other projects in the cinema for the moment.
Well, that's amazing. So if there's anybody there who knows anything about publishing, Mia's got a novel, get on it. Mia, good luck with that. And thank you all so much for joining us. Your questions were wonderful. Oh, one quick question from Dean Atta. It felt like the mum was present through magical realism with the shooting star, the weather, and the iPod seemed to have a mind of its own. Was this magical realism style just for this film, or is it something that you'll do in future films, Laurent?
Thank you for that question, because it means a lot to me, first of all, because I think this is something I'm working on from the beginning of my writing work, and I'm really trying to go into that more and more. I'm not the okay, just a second. The reality isn't enough for me. So I really need to bring something else, something more. And I definitely am going to work on that again on the next film, even though it's not specifically about undefined signs or something like that, but more about, okay, you can step out from reality or realism and make scenes that are more about feelings, about poetry and things like that. And this is really important to me.
Thank you. And it's really important to have that symbolism in modern films as well, because a lot of it is quite expositional in many ways. Thank you for that answer. Somebody's just said to send this love to Mia. It's been so much love and respect to Mia for this film. So important to young trans women to see this and her on film. So.
Et Mia, quelqu'un qui a dit qu'il t'envoie beaucoup d'amour et de respect. Et c'est si important pour des jeunes femmes trans de se voir comme ça.
And I agree too. Yes. So thank you very much, Mia.
Thank you.
Thanks, Laurent. I know it's late over there. You're 1 hour ahead. And thanks for staying and answering and being so generous for this Q&A. Thanks, Juliette, for your wonderful translations. Thanks, Alex and Amelia, for all the work behind the technicals. We don't see them, but they make us be here. And thank you, Peccadillo, for the distribution of this film. Just remember, it's in cinemas from the 17th. It will also be on Peccadillo Pod. Please tell your friends to go and see this amazing film in the UK. And we sign off now with the final message from our partners, Gendered Intelligence. Run by trans people, led by trans people, for trans people. Here's a message from Gendered Intelligence, our partner.
Gendered Intelligence is a registered charity providing support and education around gender across the UK. We are a trans-led, trans-inclusive grassroots organisation using our lived experience and community knowledge to offer youth work, training, and consultancy that are second to none. We believe in creating open and non-judgmental spaces for discussion so that everybody can explore their identities and learn about the diverse range of gender expressions and identities that make up the world. We believe that everybody can be intelligent about gender. To learn more about our work or support what we do, you can visit our website at genderedintelligence.co.uk.